everybody. Welcome to the Impressive Channel. The singer, songwriter, and reality star Candy Burris made a very interesting comment about working with Boys to Men, and I kind of wanted to talk about it in this video. A few days ago, she recently did an interview with Eddie LaVert, and she talked about some of the artists that she has worked with in the industry. Candy has written for artists like Fantasia, Destiny's Child, TLC, etc. And she also worked with Boys to Men. However, her experience with Boys to Men was pretty terrible. This is what she said.
Okay, now who was difficult now, Candy? Don't try to soft soap me. Don't you try.
I hate to do it. And you know, ain't no love lost. I mean, you know, this is 100 years later, so it doesn't even matter. But yeah, I had a bad experience in the studio with Boys to Men.
When you say bad experience,
it was bad.
They could sing, couldn't they?
No, about the singing. It wasn't about the singing at all. Yeah, it was not the singing.
Was it about the attitudes or what?
Attitudes. Yeah. We fell out after that. It was an issue. I don't think I ever been disrespected like that before in the studio in my life. It was crazy, really. You know, that was a long time ago. You know, everybody in the group, but I knew a few of them. We had hung out different times prior to being in the studio working together. So it was just kind of unexpected to me that working together would have that result. But okay. It wasn't a good situation.
Now, I thought this was rather interesting because this is not the first time we've heard about Boys to Men being jerks. In fact, the producer Dallas Austin sat down with Vlad TV and he even said that they were difficult to work with.
On the second Boys to Men album, you only produced one song. Was there a reason why you didn't continue to stick with them after having so much success on the first one?
Yeah, it was actually. I didn't like them after that. I remember I was sitting in the studio and they were going, man, you know, I can't finish counting the diamonds in my Rolex right now. And I was sitting there looking, going, what are they talking about? And then the award show comes on and they go, oh, we got to let somebody win this year. Good thing we're not there. And I'm like, these guys are assholes, you know? And it was just ridiculous how drastic of an ego change it was. And during the same sessions, Babyface comes. He opens the laptop up. All of us are sitting around and he starts singing, I'll Make Love to You. He sings the whole song. Like, he has the instrumental, but he's singing the whole song to us, right? After they finish, they go, Boys to Men looks at him and goes, see, that's what we're talking about. That's what we do. We don't need you. This is horrible. I'm like, uh-oh. So then Gerald Busby calls me back. He said, Dallas, how did it go with Babyface? I said, they just told him they don't need him, that they write the same kind of songs, and that song is horrible. He says, what? Put me on the speakerphone. Guys, I'm not asking you. I'm telling you. Do the song. Roll your sleeves up. Go to work right now. Click. And that song ended up being bigger than End of the Road. You know, so they just got to that point where they were smelling themselves so much that I from that point, I was just like, I can't believe they turned into this, really. And it became really kind of disrespectful to people and just not nice.
So that was just another account of somebody's experience working with Boys to Men. And the reason why I wanted to talk about this is because I've always wondered what really happened to Boys to Men, because Boys to Men was a very, very huge music act in the 90s. They were probably the biggest R&B male group in the 90s. They were very commercial. They had huge hits like Song for Mama, End of the Road, I'll Make Love to You, One Sweet Day with Mariah Carey. And One Sweet Day actually held the record for being number one on the Billboard charts for 16 consecutive weeks. Boys to Men was literally on top of their game in the 90s. Their first album, Coolie High Harmony, sold 9 million records in the US, And their second official album, too, sold over 12 million copies in the U.S. alone. And their third album sold 4 million copies. They were a huge act. They were selling a lot of records, and they were selling out big arenas. They were huge. But there were some factors that slowed them down in their career. And I think one of the factors was their attitude. Now, Candy and Dallas Austin talked about working with Boyz II Men, and they said they had some horrible experiences with them because of their ego. Their ego kind of got out of control because they were young guys and success came to them very easily. They had it all. They had the talent, the fame, the good looks, and the selling power. So who was gonna check them? Nobody. That's why their heads became too big. However, Boyz II Men had to go through a very humbling process. After years of being on top, their fame did start to decline. Between 1997 and 2000, there was a pop explosion that happened on the scene. Boy bands like Backstreet Boys and NSYNC started to take over. Also, hip-hop music became even more popular, and R&B music seemed to be falling by the wayside. Now, during this very critical change in the industry, Boyz II Men did take a hiatus, and when they came back on the scene, their music was not received the same way. They didn't sell as much records, and it was a very, very shocking change for them because they went from being one of the highest selling acts in the 90s to almost being an afterthought. And Boyz II Men dealt with a lot of business and money issues. It got really hectic for them in the industry. Also, they lost a very important group member, Michael McCary. Michael McCary was the bass singer in the group, and he was actually the glue to Boyz II Men's harmonies. So without his voice in the group, it did change the way Boyz II Men sounded. Michael left the group because he had some serious health problems. He suffered from multiple sclerosis and he hid his diagnosis from the group for years. It got so bad to the point that he couldn't perform anymore. Boyz II Men decided to let him go, and it was a very tough decision. Also, it was tough for Boyz II Men to get back on track. After losing their relevance in the industry, they had to start from scratch and build their fan base up again.
Simply because, you know, we started off, our career was here, you know, and, you know, we were doing so well. And, you know, we felt like at that time, you know, when the music industry was changing, that we could actually, you know, take a couple years off, you know, just relax a little bit, enjoy the, you know, the success. And when we did that, the music industry changed dramatically. And we came back and it was like, where the hell is the music? And, you know, we actually went through a phase where we actually went searching for, like, you know, where the love was, I guess we used to call it. And we would go, you know, and do shows and things like that, and it just wasn't as you know, it wasn't as great as it you know, where we would go overseas and of course and be huge and be, you know, amazing, but we live in America, so we wanted love where we were. And you know, we actually, you know, took a bit of a nosedive, you know what I mean, I guess you could say. And during that time it was very humbling. Yeah, and we did these shows, and I'm telling you, you go from performing at theaters and arenas to performing at a place called Puffer Bellies. You know, we walked in this place, and it's a mechanical bull. You know, the stage got a pole in front of it, and we get there. It's like, you know, it was literally 50 people showed up. It was 50 people there, and you would have thought that it was 5,000. Because we sang each song the way that we've always learned how to sing everything.
The way we know how.
The only way we know how is to go 120%. And as time progressed throughout those months and months and years of performing at these crazy, crazy places, you know, the numbers started building again. You know what I mean? From 50 to, you know, 100 to maybe like 500, then 5,000. And then we did the U.S. Open. And from that point, I guess, you know, like Joe said, you know, the key is to get corporate America to, you know, to believe in the brand again. And once we did that, it started, you know, building and building. But it took a very long time. And honestly, I remember being on a boat, a cruise, looking at each other like, man, this is it.
In this day and age, for us, performing is the key, because it's the only thing that we have sacred that we can offer to our fan base that you just can't go on the internet and get.
So just hearing how Boyz II Men had to start from scratch again and build their fan base back up is very interesting, because you don't hear a lot of veterans in the music industry talking about this. Boyz II Men went from selling out arenas to performing for 50 people. Like, that's crazy. That's crazy. But I'm glad that they were able to push through and build their fan base up again. And honestly, they relied on their talent. It was their talent and their work ethic that actually kept them afloat. A lot of people in their position probably would have quit music altogether, but they didn't. They continued to work. And I do think the whole process was very humbling for them, because they started off being pretty cocky, but after going through what they went through, I'm pretty sure they had to grow from that. So it's just an interesting story altogether. And I do hope one day Boyz II Men gets a biopic. I think it will be very interesting to see their life played out in film. But anyway, tell me what you all think about this video down below. Please like, comment, and subscribe, and share this video if you care. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time. Bye.